Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the University of Manitoba's 10th annual 3-minute thesis competition. I'm Colleen Brady, weather specialist and host of the Arts and Entertainment segment Spotlight on CTV News Winnipeg, and I'm very happy to be your MC for this evening. Now, just so you can place where I am, I'm actually inside the CTV Winnipeg newsroom and studios right here in downtown Winnipeg. A big thank you to everyone who has joined us online this year. And yes, we are online again, but we are so happy that everyone has tuned in to be with us this evening. Now, the 3-Minute Thesis, or 3MT, is an annual competition where graduate students from across the university compete in front of a non-specialist audience and a panel of judges. Now, they must explain their research thesis in plain language in 3 minutes or less. Not an easy task. Now, as a proud graduate of the University of Manitoba, it's always a pleasure for me to stay connected to this community. Back in 2003, I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts advanced degree with a major in political studies. But enough about me. Back to tonight's event. It is the culmination of months and months of hard work by our 12 student finalists tonight. They've put in so much time and effort, as you might imagine, into presenting engaging competitions. This presentation is going to be fast-paced, it's going to be exciting, and I, for one, am ready to get started and hope you are too. I'd now like to invite Dr. Michael Benaroche, President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Manitoba, to open this evening's event.
Thank you for the introduction. It is my pleasure to participate in this important competition. Before we go any further, we acknowledge that the University of Manitoba campuses are located on the original lands of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Ojai Cree, Dakota, and Dene peoples, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on these territories, we acknowledge the harms and mistakes of the past, and we dedicate ourselves to move forward in partnership with Indigenous communities in the spirit of reconciliation and collaboration. I'd like to welcome everyone watching online to the finals for the 3-minute thesis competition here at UM. One of the most challenging things a researcher can do is communicate effectively to someone outside of their field of expertise. For those at home, imagine having to condense months, maybe years, of exhausting and extensive and complicated work into 3 minutes of captivating, clear, and inspiring messaging. When I think back to my thesis, when my wife read my thesis, she told me that she understood the first page, understood about half of the second page, and after that, it could have all been hieroglyphics. Communicating complex ideas can be difficult, but it is one of the most important aspects of science. One excellent communicator from our community is UM alum Dr. Joss Reimer, medical lead for the Manitoba Vaccine Implementation Task Force, who calmly and clearly explains to Manitobans the findings from complex vaccination studies happening around the world, and she changes minds. Students competing today are developing these crucial skills that will serve them well in their careers going forward. I congratulate and thank each and every one of you for giving so much of yourself to this endeavor. And I thank and congratulate all your advisors as well. Well done, all of you. Our judges have a very difficult task ahead of them, and I thank them for taking on the challenge of selecting tonight's winners. Thank you also to the 3MT Organizing Committee, led by Dr. Kelly Main, Acting Dean of Graduate Studies. This is always a great event. All the best.
Invite Dr. Kelly Main, Acting Dean of the Faculty of Graduate Studies, to say a few words of welcome.
As Acting Dean of the Faculty of Graduate Studies, I'm delighted to be here to welcome you to the University of Manitoba's 10th annual 3-Minute Thesis Competition. This competition provides graduate students with the unique opportunity to explain their research in just 3 minutes. This can be a challenging task. To distill all of the research and inspiration for their graduate degree into approachable language for a lay audience. This facilitates students' communication skills and allows them to share their research with a broader audience, as we will have here tonight. For those of you who are not familiar with this event, 3MT is an academic competition for graduate students developed by the University of Queensland in Australia. The success of their model has led to competitions in several countries, as well as a French version called MT180, or Mathèse en 180 secondes, which the U of M will be broadcasting on April 19th of this year. The University of Manitoba participates in 3MT to highlight our graduate students, to promote UM research and connect with the community. I am thrilled we are able to share with you tonight just some of the work that our more than 3,900 graduate students are doing. While we will only hear from 12 finalists, this is a great showcase of the work that our graduate students do on a daily basis. This year's 3MT competition at the University of Manitoba began earlier this year when 33 individuals from 16 different departments were selected from an initial pool of over 70 talented master's and doctoral students, who then competed in one of three heats to advance to tonight's final competition. I congratulate all the challengers from each heat in their presentations and their ability to describe their research and engage the virtual audience and judges. That process determined the 12 finalists who compete tonight for the People's Choice Award, third place, the UM Retirees Association Prize for second place, and the Dr. Archie McNichol Prize for first place. The graduate student who takes home first place tonight will advance to the Western Canada Regional Competition on May 6th and will have a chance for their presentation to be featured in a showcase of 3MT videos from graduate students across Canada. Graduate students are a fundamental part of the university's research program. By sharing their love of research, we hope you will come away with a greater understanding of how their research contributions can pave the way for future advancements that will improve our lives in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, both to Dr. Benarosh and to Dr. Main. Now, if you would like to learn more about our amazing students who are presenting tonight, I'd invite you to read the event program. You can find that at umanitoba.ca/3MT. There you'll find their biographies, the bios of tonight's judges, and a list of all the students who competed in the heat. Now, the rules for tonight's competition are as follows. Each finalist is allowed just one slide to support their presentation. Their presentation must be 3 minutes or less, not a second longer, or they will be disqualified. And finally, the finalists will be judged on comprehension, content, engagement, and communication. While presenting, the students will have a monitor facing them with a countdown clock so they know exactly how much time they have left. Now, during each presentation, the judges will take notes, of course. You are welcome to do the same so you can choose your favorite presenter for the People's Choice Award during the break. Following the presentations, the judges will head off to a private breakout room to deliberate. Now, at this point, a link will appear on screen for menti.com. Now, this free platform will allow you to cast your vote for the People's Choice Award. I'll give you instructions on how to use Menti after the students have presented. I'd now like to introduce you to our judges, starting with Joe Funk. Now, Joe is the Assistant Deputy Minister of Advanced Education. Joe is also a two-time alum of the University of Manitoba. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you, Colleen. Look forward to it. Good luck, everybody. Look forward to seeing your hard work.
Thank you so much. Now, next up, Colleen Rajot. Now, Colleen is the CEO of Vitality Television and co-founder and artistic director of the Winnipeg Aboriginal Film Festival. Colleen is also a UM alum. Welcome, Colleen.
Thank you. So nice to be here, and I'm excited to see everyone's presentations.
Thank you. And finally, we have Mark Evans. Mark is president and CEO of Conquest Planning Incorporated. Mark is also a UM alum. Welcome.
Hi, Colleen. Great to be here. Looking forward to the presentations and a good competition.
Thank you so much. And with that, I'd like to thank all of you for making the time to be with us tonight. Good luck choosing your favorites. You will certainly have a tough job ahead of you, as I'm sure you're anticipating. Now, for those who want to join the online conversation, tweeting is encouraged, and the event hashtags are hashtag 3MT, so that's the number 3, hashtag 3MT, and M and T are capitalized, hashtag UManitoba, all in lowercase, and finally, hashtag UMResearch and UMR are also capitalized. Now, on with the competition. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first finalist, Wei-Ann Yan. Wei-Ann's thesis title is New Immunoengineered Biomaterials to Prevent Rejection of Transplanted Hearts.
On September 14, 1967, 53-year-old Louis Washkansky, a grocer and avid sportsman, was readmitted to Groote Hospital in Cape Town, South Africa. His diagnosis, end-stage heart failure. Prognosis, weeks. Treatment options, none, save for a procedure that had never been performed in human history, a heart transplant. And less than 3 months later, Dr. Christian Barnard, a heart surgeon, and his team had done just that, the first human-to-human heart transplant in history. The operation was successful, and amidst the media frenzy on the hospital ward, Lewis was recorded speaking to his surgeon, his wife, and reporters just 33 hours after the operation. Lewis only lived for 18 days following his transplant. He died from pneumonia that developed as a complication of the primitive anti-rejection medications he was receiving at that time. Over the next 3.5 years, another 163 people would go on to have heart transplants, and 142 of them would die, the majority from rejection or complications from anti-rejection medications. It wouldn't be until the development of a new class of anti-rejection medications in the early 1980s that outcomes began to improve. However, even today, patients who have heart transplants face ongoing complications from rejection. In particular, a unique and aggressive form of heart disease affects the blood vessels of the transplanted heart due to chronic inflammation within the heart. My research looks at new ways to tackle that problem. My lab is currently developing immunoengineered nanomaterials that can control or modulate the immune response and therefore ward off inflammation. In particular, my research looks at new zero-dimensional quantum dots produced from the transition metal carbide mixing. Here, we have synthesized tantalum carbide mixing quantum dots using a newly developed process. These quantum dots are 2 to 7 nanometers in size, abundant with surface functional groups, readily interacted with cells, and were highly biocompatible over long periods of time. Next, I tested these tantalum carbide quantum dots in the lab by culturing treated endothelial cells with immune cells derived from a different individual. The quantum dots were readily taken up into the endothelial cells and changed their immunologic behaviors. After 1 week of culture, treated endothelial cells had significantly less ability to activate donor-derived immune cells. When we looked at gene expression within these endothelial cells, we found significant decreases in key genes required for activation of foreign immune cells. Finally, when we tested them in a rat model of transplant rejection, animals who received an intravenous injection of tantalum carbide quantum dots had significantly less rejection of transplanted tissues. So where to from here? This was just the first report on the development and immunomodulatory application of these quantum dots. My lab is currently working on continuing development and optimization of these quantum dots so that one day a clinically available nanomedicine can be made available for these patients. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Wei-Ann. I know that being first up to present is never an easy task, so thank you so much for your presentation this evening. Our next finalist is Olia Mihalichuk. Olia's thesis title is Shining Light on Microglial Responses in Alzheimer's Disease.
One Sunday morning, I came to visit my grandparents. I saw my grandma, who recently retired, and she asked me what day it is today. During my visit, she asked me that same question multiple times. Over the years, she started getting more and more forgetful and progressively lost the ability to carry out the simplest tasks. She was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Many of you might know that the main driver of Alzheimer's progression is accumulation of amyloid beta. These misfolded proteins are sticky and block communication between the brain cells that are called neurons. The first region of the brain that is affected is called the hippocampus and is responsible for forming memories. That is why memory loss is the first symptom. But I'm going to tell you right now that it is not the amyloid beta itself, but the inflammation that it causes that is responsible for the loss of memory. Inflammation being the key player in the progression of Alzheimer's is the hot topic right now in research. So what do I mean when I say inflammation in the brain? And does it mean that inflammation is always bad? The quick answer is no. Inflammation is not bad. It is alarming our immune cells that there is a problem that needs to be dealt with. Let me give you an example. Imagine that there is a fire in the house and an alarm system goes off to notify the fire department to come and help extinguish the fire. Alarm is an inflammation, and without it, we would not know where the fire is. So the cells in our brain that recognize amyloid beta and act as fire officers are called microglia. In a healthy brain, microglia does a lot of beneficial things, protects us against different pathogens like bacteria, fungi, or viruses. However, in Alzheimer's disease, the abundance of amyloid beta makes microglia to switch their functions, and they start directly damaging neurons, like adding fuel to the fire, by causing chronic inflammation. And let me tell you that chronic inflammation is bad. In my project, I'm working on finding ways to inhibit chronic inflammation caused by microglia. I look at what effect it will have on the strength of neuronal connections. How? I measure their electrical activity by applying electrical impulses to the brain cells. I see that even 2 hours exposure to amyloid beta can decrease memory. Imagine what a lifetime can do. Alzheimer's disease affects female and male population differently, and inflammatory responses in men and women have different mechanisms. Therefore, I'm using both female and male mice models of Alzheimer's disease in my experiments. And so far, my results are promising, and they show that by manipulating microglia responses and preventing chronic inflammation, we can preserve neuronal function and prevent memory loss. And even though we are still gaining insight on the role of inflammation in Alzheimer's, it is worth doing it. And I hope that through this work, we will be able to help someone else's grandma. Thank you.
Olya Mihalichuk, thank you so much. Now, as you can already tell, we've learned a lot already this evening, and there's so much more to come, of course. That brings us to our next finalist. His name is Ryan Ha. Ryan's thesis title, Development of a New Method for Studying Legionella Infections.
Research saves lives. Through research, we've been able to come up with treatments and prevention methods for diseases that were previously considered death sentences, such as influenza and coronavirus. But what if I told you that there's another outbreak waiting for us just around the corner? This will be caused by Legionella, a bacteria known to cause severe lung damage and even death. And I hate to break it to you, but we are not prepared. We have no vaccines, our treatments are limited, and our detection methods are heavily flawed. And while we remain unarmed against this bacterium, Legionella cases are dramatically increasing, year after year after year. So, you're probably thinking, if Legionella is such a big issue, then why don't we just study it? Why don't we just come up with a treatment or a vaccine? I wish it were that easy. But while we lack the tools to treat Legionella infections in the clinic, we also lack tools to study it within our labs. And the issue? Our current methods fail to recreate the complexity of our lungs. To address this issue, my research aims to develop what we call a trans-well culture. What most scientists do when they study infections is they take some cells, they infect it with bacteria or viruses, and then they look at it to see what happens. But this fails to recreate the complexity of our lungs. Within our lungs, there are different layers with different cells, with different functions, all working together to fight off infections. With the transwell culture, we address this issue by having different compartments with different cells, with different functions, recreating the environment of our lungs. With this tool, we can study how Legionella enters our lungs, disrupts the lung barrier, and causes disease. And once we understand how all of these processes happen, we can come up with ways to treat Legionella. We can come up with vaccines, we can come up with treatments to protect us from Legionella infections. We've seen just how many avoidable deaths we could have overcome with coronavirus if only we had worked for it in time. With Legionella, with this tool, we can further study Legionella and come up with treatments to prevent all these unnecessary deaths before they even occur. While Legionella may not be a very big problem today, we must work swiftly and study it before it becomes tomorrow's issue. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ryan. As you can see, tonight's three-minute thesis competition is really giving our graduate students the chance to showcase some very exciting research. Now, up next, our finalist number four is Caitlin Weisgerber. Caitlin's thesis title is Investigating Spontaneous Autopolyploidy in Wild and Hatchery Lake Sturgeon.
In Manitoba, lake sturgeon are a historical species, having evolved 184 million years ago and being significant to our Indigenous communities socially and culturally. So much so that local First Nations have over 100 documented uses for sturgeon. Unfortunately, in the early 1900s, commercial exploitation decimated their populations, and while conservation efforts have been extensive, the species has yet to fully bounce back. I believe that as our knowledge of the species increases, so too will its population sizes. So in the spirit of increasing knowledge, let me tell you a little what we know and how my research plans to contribute. Lake sturgeon naturally have 8 pairs of chromosomes, meaning they are octoploid, or 8N. During fertilization, however, if the female fails to divide her chromosomes properly, the offspring will receive additional copies, 4 to be specific, making the offspring 12N. This is what's called spontaneous autopolyploidy, because the female spontaneously holds on to all of her chromosomes, and it happens more often if physical shock or egg aging occur during fertilization. Both shock and aging occur more often in hatcheries than in the wild, and since our 12N are fertile, they can spawn with 8N individuals, producing progeny which are 10N. And it's the 10N individuals that are really problematic because they're prone to defects that inhibit their ability to survive. So if even one 12N fish contributes to the next generation, thousands of offspring would be 10N and have those defects. My research plans to evaluate and compare the ploidies between the wild and the hatchery populations, where I'm expecting to find more 10N and 12N fish in the hatchery because of that increased chance of disturbance. I'll be using a non-invasive blood sample to determine ploidy, where the blood cell size is indicative of ploidy because a larger cell has more chromosomes, or the chromosomes make the cell larger. For the purpose of conserving this historic species, it is really important that we have an inclusive understanding of all the factors that might affect hatchery success. So you can think of this research as a quality control check for the hatchery managers that have spent the last 20 years stalking sturgeon back into the wild. I'll be providing them the necessary feedback to ensure that the future generations have stable sturgeon populations like their ancestors did.
Thank you so much, Caitlin. Now, I have to say the word autopolyploidy was not a word that I was familiar with until preparing for this evening's competition. I can tell you, I will not forget it after tonight. Thank you so much for your presentation. Our next finalist is Chitra Sivakumar. Chitra's thesis title is Non-Destructive Analysis of Pulse Flowers.
Look around, spring is here. Let's celebrate the season by baking a cake. Now I go to the store, buy all the necessary ingredients and bake my favorite cake. But something doesn't turn out quite right. When I taste it, it is not satisfying or something that I would be proud to present to my friends at a party. Suddenly, I remember that I used general purpose flour rather than cake flour. Checking the recipe again, I realized the reason why my cake won't win any prizes. You may be surprised to know that the taste and nutritional value of our foods does not just depend on the raw ingredients, but also on how flour is milled. How can we make the flour more guilt-free, more responsible, more sustainable, more nutritious? Incorporating low-cost protein sources like pulse flours, such as milled beans, peas, lentils, that are capable of nitrifying and restoring soil into popular foods such as breads, cookies, and pastas will increase the nutritional value of such foods. And guess what's more? It is also a step towards building a hunger-free world. Imagine having a chocolatey pulse cake. Sounds yummy, eh? It would be both healthy and delicious. But imagine if, when you are enjoying your cake, suddenly you find a piece of dough. This could be a result of uneven size of the flour particles, starch damage, and protein quality of the flours. Interestingly, most of these parameters depend on the milling method. Milling a pulse flour with specific requirements is not an easy task. Unlike wheat flours, there are no standard well-defined milling processes that exist for pulse flours. Also, blending pulse flours from different milling fractions changes overall chemical composition, which in turn affect their functional and nutritional properties. Therefore, in my thesis, four types of Canadian-grown pulses are milled using a roller mill. The flours are blended into various streams to study their microstructure using non-destructive imaging techniques. Specifically, I will look at the flours microscopically to see the structural difference between starch and protein bodies. This study will be important to define pulse flour mill settings so that the flour with required specifications can be created. These specifications are essential for food processors to develop designer pulse flour blends for more wholesome and nourishing foods. Consumers can be provided with affordable, fulfilling food with excellent texture and mouthfeel for a hunger-free, sound sleep. Now, we all know that for every baked good and confection, there is a specific flour that would best suit it. Given the option, we might all choose a healthier baking option that will salivate many palates. Have your cake and eat it too. Thank you.
Have your cake and eat it too. Thank you so much, Chitra. Now, just a reminder, if you would like to join the online conversation, please feel free to tweet. Once again, the hashtags are #3MT, #UManitoba, and #UMResearch. Our next finalist is Alexander Arusho. Alexander's thesis title, Impacts of Restoration, Assessing if Grazing by Reintroduced Plains Bison Affects Bird Abundance and Diversity in Banff National Park.
In 2017, Parks Canada placed 17 plains bison into the backcountry of Banff National Park. This is a hugely significant project because most plains bison herds that exist today live on small patches of land that can only support a small number of animals. The Banff herd, by contrast, will be able to support up to 1,000 animals living in a 1,200 square kilometer reintroduction zone, where they will roam unfenced and will be subject to predation. And this is cool because it allows them to continue their traditional role as ecosystem engineers. So what that means is that historically, plains bison and fire were two of the big forces that contributed to the expansion of grassland ecosystems across North America. And then you can imagine, right, if we put bison back onto any landscape, they are going to radically change what's already living there. So it's important for, say, other managers who are thinking of putting bison back onto the landscape to understand how these changes are going to affect what species are already living there, right? You can imagine if you have an endangered species on your land, you don't want the bison to put them at further risk of extinction. Now, we want to learn from reintroductions like Banff's herd, but they pose an interesting challenge because they've only been on the landscape for 5 years and we only have 62 animals. So one of the ways we can start learning from them is to look at these early signs through indicators in the ecosystem. Specifically, what I'm interested in looking at are birds. See, birds are sensitive to changes in their environment. And specifically, they're sensitive to changes in vegetation structure. Think like the height of a plant. So when bison go across the landscape, they don't graze in a uniform pattern, right? They're not like lawnmowers. They go to certain areas, they graze them really heavily, and other areas they graze a lot more light. And what my project does is I set up a bunch of monitoring stations across this reintroduction zone. Some of them are in those heavily grazed areas, other ones are in lightly grazed areas. So we go in and we say, okay, based on the data from the GPS collars that the bison are wearing, we know that they're spending a lot of time here, so we're assuming it's heavily grazed. We see this change in the vegetation community. It's a lot shorter than, say, the lightly grazed area. Now, we link that heavy grazing to then a change in the bird community. So we look at the diversity, the number of species there, and the abundance, so the number of members of each of those species. And we can say, all right, if we have this level of grazing on the landscape, we see this change in the vegetation community, and the bird community responds in kind. This provides other managers in other areas a bit of an early indicator, right? It gives them some information as to how bison affect other species in the landscape. It allows us to continue to reintroduce these wonderful animals across their former range in a way that is healthy and doesn't compromise what's already there.
Thank you so much, Alexander. Now, if you can believe it, everybody, we have now reached the halfway point in this evening's 3-minute thesis competition. So without further ado, let's get started on the second half. And with that, our next finalist is Alakia Lavu. Alakia's thesis title is Anti-Seizure Treatments During Pregnancy and Neonatal Birth Outcomes.
Imagine a pregnant woman well into her third trimester walking down a busy street. And suddenly she has a seizure. Just imagining the scenario is scary as it can lead to unwanted consequences. For example, the infant can have hypoxia, that is, decreased supply of oxygen to infant's brain, leading to adverse neonatal outcomes in adulthood. Or the seizure can cause fall in the pregnant woman, leading to trauma in both mother and child, resulting in death. Therefore, it is extremely important to treat these seizures. But anti-seizure medication, when taken during pregnancy, can also cause adverse outcomes in neonates, like malformations or being born preterm. Therefore, mothers always ask this question: should I take the drug or should I not take the drug? Is this medication safe for my baby? And physicians are always on the search to find the best anti-seizure medication with the best seizure control. My research will help answer this conundrum. I'll be doing two projects as part of my thesis. First, I'm currently doing a systematic review and meta-analysis, which will summarize all the published evidence which have been published up until this point of time on anti-seizure exposure during pregnancy and neonatal birth weight outcomes. We found that women who are exposed to anti-seizure medications have 55% increased risk of having an infant with low birth weight than compared with unexposed women, showing that indeed there is an association between anti-seizure exposure during pregnancy and neonatal birth weight outcomes. Now that we have established this association in the literature, the next step is to search for this association in Canadian populations. Therefore, as part of my second project, I'll be doing a pan-Canadian cohort study, which will include administrative health databases from Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and Quebec. This cohort will include 1.5 million pregnancies over the past 25 years, where I'll study the association of anti-seizure medications during pregnancy and neonatal birth outcomes, including preterm birth, as well as various adverse birth weight outcomes. The knowledge generated from this project will help in pre-counseling women who plan to get pregnant, and also help ensure pregnant women to take their medications to avoid unwanted seizures, therefore ultimately avoiding unwanted consequences. The knowledge will also help physicians to choose an anti-seizure medication with the best seizure control and the least risk of adverse birth outcomes. Therefore, ultimately improving the health of mothers and neonates, not only in Canada, but also around the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alakia. Now, as you can tell, all the different topics tonight are very broad and diverse, and we've already learned so much. And we're about to keep on learning. And with that, our next finalist is Janelle Francis. Janelle's thesis title, Waterways or Rivers as Vehicles of Enteric Viruses.
After 6 months of minus 30 degree weather, you and your loved ones finally get to enjoy a beach on a summer day. In preparation for the long-awaited beach day, you ensure to pack all the essential items: sunscreen, snacks, water bottle, and swimsuits. You prepare lunch for the kids and get everyone ready into the car. Once you get there, you find the perfect spot with just enough shade. You set up your umbrellas and beach chairs as you watch your kids run off into the water. At this moment, all is safe in your mind. But as reported by the Government of Canada, waterborne enteric viral outbreaks have occurred in groundwaters of Alberta and Ontario at 11% positive sample frequency in 2013. Some viral outbreaks also go unperceived or just aren't reported. Now, I probably worried you and left you wondering what might be the cause. The truth is, Traditional methods that monitor the microbial quality of our wastewater focus only on the detection of fecal bacteria. This is because fecal bacteria is the current gold standard of microbial aquatic health. However, this can also be partial because the results of a negative fecal bacteria test often disregard the presence of other significant types of waterborne pathogens, such as viruses. My research project addresses this shortfall in microbial detection. We hypothesized that enteric viruses may be used as one form of an alternative proxy of anthropogenic activities in urban aquatic environments. Skimmed milk flocculation, a simple yet reliable technique used in the lab, is able to concentrate viruses from aquatic samples. As shown on my slide, numbered 1 through 11 are samples that I collected along the shores of the Red and Assiniboine rivers of Winnipeg. Through sequencing, I've been able to determine the functionality and taxonomic classifications of viruses present. As shown in the pie chart, we discovered that Cyphoviridae, Podoviridae, and Myoviridae are top families of pathogenic DNA-enteric viruses, while Totoviridae and Picobinoviridae are top families of pathogenic RNA-enteric viruses that are all most abundant in our local rivers. 270 million liters of effluent are discharged into the environment per day. So can you just imagine how many viruses are present in our surface waters? But this is just the beginning. These findings will encourage continuous screening of additional enteric viruses over longer sampling event periods that may lead to the development of novel viral markers of fecal contamination.
Thank you so much, Janelle. Now, I just want to take a moment here once again to thank everyone for joining us this evening. And as you can tell, our judges have a very tough job ahead of them tonight, and we're not done yet. We'll move on to our next presentation. Our next finalist is Daniel Schwade Harusho. His thesis title is Examining the Associations Between Different Physical Fitness Phenotypes and Cardiovascular Risk Factors in Older Females.
Heart disease is the number one cause of death in the world. How do we stop it? I've dedicated my research career to answering this question, and it just so happens that the best tool available to prevent heart disease is free and accessible to nearly everyone. And of course, I'm talking about exercise. Now, you have probably heard that exercising is good for you, but different types of exercise can lead to completely different adaptations. Think of a marathon runner and a weightlifter, for example. These observable adaptations are called phenotypes. And this made me wonder, what is the best phenotype for a healthy heart? To answer this question, I performed a secondary analysis of data from 1,000 females aged 55 and older from a previous study. I chose to study this population because I wanted to frame this issue in a clinical perspective. Older adults are the population at the most risk for cardiovascular disease. And females, specifically, are underrepresented in cardiovascular research when compared to males. I divided these participants in five different groups according to their phenotypes of muscle strength and aerobic fitness. I used the six-minute walk test as a measure of aerobic fitness and the hand grip strength as a measure of, and the hand grip test as a measure of strength. These tests are simple, practical, and can be easily incorporated in a clinical setting. The participants who scored above the 75 percentile in these tests were considered as being fit or strong, and those who scored below the 25th percentile were considered as being unfit or weak. All remaining participants were assigned to the normal group. And what I found was quite interesting. When looking at the Framingham risk score, which is the percentage of risk of developing cardiovascular disease in the next 10 years, the strong and unfit group showed no significant differences compared to the weak and unfit group. However, when you look at the groups who were classified as being fit, not only did they have lower risk scores, but there were no significant differences between the groups classified as fit but weak and fit and strong. Now, the main takeaway from this is not that strength is important. It is crucial for many functional outcomes, especially in older adults. However, when talking specifically about the cardiovascular disease risk of older females, it seems like the protective effect of aerobic fitness is much higher than the one of muscle strength. And knowing this is very important because a large part of the work that doctors do consists in interpreting the phenotypes of their patients in order to be able to prescribe treatment. Because of this, my work will provide healthcare professionals with the information that they need to help their patients walk away from heart disease. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Daniel. Now, I mentioned this earlier, but if you can believe, this is already the 10th annual 3-minute thesis competition at the University of Manitoba. I know I, for one, I'm really enjoying hearing about so much exciting research, and I sure hope that you are as well. We'll now hear from our final three finalists, and our next finalist is Pranav Mishra. Pranav's thesis title is Potential of Sex Hormone Estrogen in Prevention of Alzheimer's Disease, a Sex-Based Study.
What if I tell you I forgot what I was going to say? Fortunately, that's not the case today. We all have moments like this where we forget things. And yes, it doesn't seem to be so serious. But this lady in the bottom of the picture, she had known the dog for 6 years. One day she went out to walk the dog and came back alone. And let me tell you, she did not lose the dog. Rather, she completely forgot she even had one. Isn't this forgetfulness serious? Such loss of memory can worsen to a point where people have forgotten who they were. So when they went out, they never came, as they couldn't remember their way back home. Sadly, in Canada alone, over 500,000 people are suffering from such loss of memory. This condition is called as Alzheimer's disease. It is a neurodegenerative disorder characterized by increasingly worsening memory with age. And unfortunately, 65% of those are women. A key fact that most of us know is that with aging, females undergo menopause. But what you probably did not know was that with menopause comes major changes in the body, one of which is a rapid decline in the levels of sex hormone called estrogen. This hormone is a special chemical that plays an important role in formation of memory in the brain and is a key focus of my PhD thesis. Falling levels of estrogen can lead to increase in inflammation and decrease in mitochondrial function inside the brain. Inflammation, a process that is there to protect the brain, now turns against it and eats it up. Parts of the brain literally break down over time. While mitochondria, which we all call the powerhouse of the cell and generates energy, it also stops functioning properly. Remember how electrical appliances get damaged with power fluctuations? Similarly, the brain gets damaged with mitochondrial dysfunction. And all of this contributes to loss of memory. And even though majority of people suffering from Alzheimer's are women, the rest are men. Which is why I am conducting my research on both women and men at the same time and making use of not one, but two animal models for a more reliable outcome. Although Alzheimer's was first recognized as a disease over 100 years ago, we still don't have an effective treatment, but I strongly believe I'm on my way to find one. As in my recent experiments, I have been able to increase the energy levels in these brain cells using estrogen. And yes, the results are promising. This disease alone demands a lot of attention globally, as sooner or later, it is going to affect most of our lives as we are all associated with the aging population, including our own beloved parents. But let me tell you, there's nothing to worry about because estrogen alone has the potential to keep the memory safe. And soon, anyone who goes out, they will be able to find their way back home. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pranav. Now, again, just a reminder, if you'd like to join the online conversation on Twitter, there are three hashtags you can use this evening. They are hashtag 3MT, hashtag UManitoba, and hashtag UMResearch. Well, we have two more presentations left, so we will head on to our second to last presentation of the evening. Our next finalist is Chioma Victoria Wachuku. Chioma's thesis title, Electrical stimulation improves walking and organ function after spinal cord injury, but how?
Physical exercise. Think about what happens when you go hiking or cycling with family or jogging with friends. You naturally begin to sweat. Your heart rate rises and so does your blood pressure. These are your body organs working like a team to support your movement and activities. But this perfect balance and harmony within your body can get shattered in a few seconds if you sustain a spinal cord injury, and that leads to dramatic consequences. These include a new reality of living with paralysis. And what is more devastating is that the functions of many organs drastically become altered. In essence, people with spinal cord injury can only rest and digest and lose their ability for fight or flight. Sooner than later, this same individual starts to develop sedentary-related diseases like obesity, respiratory, and heart problems that will eventually kill them, and at much earlier ages. Restoring the functionality of body organs to reasonable levels after spinal cord injury has been a major concern for affected individuals and scientists alike. Interestingly, we have discovered that by passing simple electric currents to the lower part of the spinal cord, people with spinal cord injury can regain their ability to use their legs, stand, and walk. Now, here is the more exciting part. Not only are they able to take steps again, but they show significant improvement in the functioning of these major organs that are supplied by nerves far away from the site of stimulation. How does this magic happen? We don't know, and that is where I come in. My goal is to determine whether there is a connection between the nerves for walking and the nerves that supply these vital organs that support movement and life overall. Using the mouse model, I will pass electric currents to the lower spinal cord to activate the nerves that produce walking, and at the same time, look at the activity of those nerve cells found higher up in the spinal cord that branch out to different body organs. More clearly put, our idea of restoring spinal cord functions after injury is similar to fixing the broken engine of a car. The engine in this case is the spinal cord, and like a car engine, the injured spinal cord requires some electrical power to restart it and in turn reactivate malfunctioning organs. If I can demonstrate how specific groups of nerve cells talk to each other during stimulation, then we will be able to better activate the organs using more precise forms of stimulation, enabling people with spinal cord injury walk in a new direction towards a healthier lifestyle. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chioma. Well, it's been really exciting to hear about so much varied graduate research at the University of Manitoba, but we are not done just yet. We have one more finalist, and our final finalist is Shayna Giesbrecht. Shayna's thesis title is Molecular Detection and Quantification of the Prevalence of Sexually Transmitted Bloodborne Infections in Canadian Wastewater Samples.
A major concern we've all had during this pandemic is that COVID would make its way into our communities undetected. Given the limited accessibility of clinical testing and the fact that many regions have all but stopped publicly reporting COVID cases, how would our community leaders even know there was an outbreak until it was too late? Well, that's where my project comes in. My project focuses on using wastewater or raw sewage for tracking infectious disease. So how on earth can you track infectious disease using sewage? Well, for certain infections, viral or bacterial particles are shed in a person's urine or stool, and those particles end up in community sewage. We can isolate those particles and extract their genetic material to determine both whether a particular pathogen was present or not, and if it was, how much was present. Because sewage is communal, the data collected is unbiased, with coverage from every resident. How? Well, I think author Taro Gomi said it best in his 1977 children's story, "Everybody Poops." During the COVID-19 pandemic, many remote communities here in Canada began using wastewater testing to monitor for COVID-19. There are actually a few examples of communities detecting COVID in the wastewater when no known case existed within the community at the time. This prompted them to implement widespread testing, and they were able to identify the asymptomatic cluster. After the success of using wastewater testing for COVID-19, some communities inquired about using this method of surveillance for other infections, including sexually transmitted infections, or STIs. My job is to develop and optimize methods for detection of common STIs, including gonorrhea and syphilis. In Canada, the rates of gonorrhea and syphilis have increased by 400 to 500% in the last 10 years, and STI cases are known to be greatly underreported. So improved surveillance is drastically needed to slow what can only be described as an epidemic. The hope is that wastewater testing can help us identify regions with high rates of STIs so that public health can target healthcare and educational resources towards affected communities. This is especially impactful in Northern Canada, where the rates of STIs are 10 to 20 times the national average, and access to healthcare can be incredibly limited. Overall, targeted allocation of healthcare resources to affected communities represents an equitable allocation of healthcare resources for all. I think that this project has the potential to make a real difference. So thank you for taking the time to listen to me today.
Well, thank you so much, Shayna. And Shayna was our final finalist. My goodness, what an impressive group. Thank you to all the challengers for such impressive presentations. Thank you also to you, the audience, for your support and enthusiasm for grad research. Judging panel, please now move to the secure breakout room for your deliberations. Now, while the judges are deliberating, it is time for the viewers at home to vote for the People's Choice Award. A slideshow recap of all the finalists will be shown on the screen during this time. So please go vote right now. Well, thank you to everyone for voting for your favorite presenter. I'd like to introduce our musical entertainment who will perform while the judges continue to choose the winners. Please welcome two alumni of the University of Manitoba Jazz Studies Program, Elizabeth Sadler on vocals and Casey Kurtz on guitar.
Good evening, 3MT candidates. My name is Elizabeth Sadler, and with me on guitar, I have the amazing Casey Kurtz. We both graduated in the same year, 2020, from the U of M, from the jazz faculty. We're really excited and thankful to be part of your event, providing some entertainment. We have some fun covers planned for you. A big thanks to the U of M for having us and to the planning committee for inviting us back. This is Casey's first time, and this is my third time, and it's a really fun event. I always love watching all of you do your thesis competitions. Best of luck to you all, and we hope you enjoy the music.
The highest mountains, I have run through the fields only to be with you, only to be with you. I have run, I have crawled, I have scaled these city walls, only to be with you. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I have kissed honey lips, felt the healing in her fingertips. It burned like fire, this burning desire. I have spoke with the tongues of angels. I have held the hand of the devil. Is warm in the night. I was cold as a stone, but I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But I still and the land is dark, and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. Stand by me. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. You say there's so much you don't know. You need to go and find yourself. You say you'd rather be alone, 'cause you think you won't find it tied to someone else. Who says it's true that the growing only happens on your own? They don't know me. You can change right next to me. When you're high, I'll take the lows. You can ebb and I can flow. And we'll take it slow and grow as we go. Grow as we go. Left to learn. I don't know how this river runs, but I'd like some company through every twist and turn. Who said it's true that the growing only happens on your own? They don't know me. Change is what you need. You can change right next to me. When you're high, I'll take the lows. You can ebb and I can flow. And we'll take it slow and grow as we go. Tell me you don't want to leave. If to change is what you need, you can change right next to me. When you're high, I'll take the lows. You can ebb and I can flow. And we'll take it slow and grow as we go. Grow as we go.
Our third and final song is a song called At Your Mother's House. It is sung by Rachel and Villery. It's a little lesser known, but it's very fun, very cheeky. And again, thank you for having us. If you want to find more of us, you can find Casey and I through my Instagram, The Sadler Sisters Music. And we hope to see you again soon. Thank you.
Everybody knows there's only one place to go when you want to hear the news that heads to your mother's house, where we all talk about you. They show me pictures of little you in the nude, and it would be rude of me not to let them see the ones that I took of you. It's true, you've been a Jew to me, and I said a sad farewell. But I never agree if you asked it of me to bid goodbye to your mama as well. All you lovers know there's only one place to go when you want to hear the news. That's to your mother's house, where we all talk about you.
Well, welcome back, everyone. Thank you so much to our judges for being with us tonight and for doing that difficult job of choosing the winners among these very impressive competitors. I'm sure you're as anxious to hear the results as I am. So without further ado, let me call on Dr. Main to present tonight's winners.
Thank you, Colleen. All right, so our first announced winner for this evening is for the People's Choice Award. And so the People's Choice winner for this evening is Chioma Victoria Wachuku. Congratulations. Moving on to our next prize for this evening, the next announced prize will be for third place. And so the third place award winner who is going to receive $750 is Caitlin Weisgerberger.
Oh, thank you guys so much. That's amazing. Thank you.
Congratulations, Caitlin. Next, we will move on to announce the winner of second place. So this evening's second place winner and winner of the UM Retirees Association Prize of $1,250 is Shayna Giesbrecht.
Hi, everybody. Thank you. I'd like to give a special thank you to my advisor, Dr. Michael Becker, as well as all my wonderful friends and family and my track team who all came to support me tonight. Thank you for this award.
Congratulations, Shayna. And moving on to the last presentation for this evening, our first place winner. Our first place winner will receive the Dr. Archie McNichol Prize of $2,500 And first place this evening goes to Pranav Mishra.
Yeah. I want to take this moment to thank everyone, especially my advisors, Dr. Fernie Yu and Dr. Elbenzi, who have guided me all this time. I want to thank my parents, my brother Korov, and all my friends. And I feel very excited. I don't know what to say right now, but I also want to thank Judy and Teddy. They've been really nice. They coordinated so well. And thank you so much. And thanks to University of Manitoba, of course.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So that brings us to the end of 3MT and the 10th anniversary edition this year for 2022. I'd like to thank everyone for attending this evening. So I'd like to again thank our host, our judges, all of the competitors who are here this evening, as well as the audience for voting and attending to support all of our graduate students and their amazing research being done at U of M. So I'd like to thank everyone once again for joining us this evening and wish everyone a good night.